I'm trying to tell you that it becomes a Guinness World Record. It becomes the world's largest camera trap wildlife survey. So it was in news. This all factual data is not that much important. This particular species, that is a tiger, and the tiger reserve, it becomes important. For the increase of the number of the tigers, there were many initiatives were taken. One of the initiative was T cross 2. What was this T cross 2? This T cross 2 means we have to take the efforts, we have to take the conservation and protection effort so that the tiger population can be doubled. Doubled, let's say in the case of India, whatever tiger population is there, let's say it's an imaginary number, 100, for example. Then when this particular initiative, T cross 2, when it is taken, then what will be the aim? Aim will be to become 200 tiger. Okay, so whatever was the goal for India, in the case of India, India have to achieve this goal till 2020. Not only India, for 30 countries were there. I will provide you the list of those countries in the further slides. But India achieved this goal before the deadline. Deadline was 2022, but India achieved this deadline of doubling the tiger's number much before the deadline. Okay, so if we talk about the India, then what is the tiger's number and how much tiger population in India have? In the case of India, it is approximately 2,967, means roughly we can say 3,000 tiger is there. They are not going to ask you the number of tigers, but roughly you should have some idea. And this tiger population is nearly 70%. They will not ask exactly 70%. They will frame the statement so a very clever manner. How they will ask that the India have around more than 2/3 of the tiger population. So 2/3 becomes around 66%. So the statement will be correct because India is hosting nearly 70%. This percentage may vary because according to the number of tiger increase or decrease, but roughly it is nearly 70%. Okay, so they will frame the statement in a very, very smart way. So if you are not knowing the exact number, you should know the trend. What is the trend? Here in this case, the trend is that more than 2/3 of the tiger population of the world is in India. Okay. And what was this aim? This aim was made at the St. Petersburg in 2010 to doubling the tiger's number. The initiative was T cross 2. And India achieved this initiative much before the target year was 2022. And India achieved it before the 2022. Okay. So you need to remember this T cross 2. What is T cross 2? This particular question also came in prelims, one of the prelims examination. So if we talk about this fourth cycle of All India Tiger Estimation, so what was the highlights? The highlights become important. Highlights are the latest data and they can frame the question on the basis of latest data. According to this cycle of All India Tiger Estimation, highest number of tiger is in MP. You need to remember this particular point. How much number is not that much important. The state MP, after that Karnataka. The difference is very slight difference here, 526 and 524, but it is in second position. After that, Uttarakhand. Okay, you need to remember MP, Karnataka, and then Uttarakhand. Sorry. And what is other trend? Other trend is that in this years, the number of protected area for the protection of the tiger that have been increased. Earlier, when in 1973, when the Project Tiger, this particular project was started for the conservation and protection of the tiger, this project started in 1972. Then there were 9 tiger reserves in the country. But now if we talk about latest data, there are around 50 tiger reserves in the country. So the protected areas for the protection of a particular species that has increased. It is one of the observation of this cycle of this fourth cycle of All India Tiger Estimation. Okay. If we talk about the number from 2006, the tiger population was 1411. In 2010, it was 1706. In 2014, it is 2226, and in 2018, it is 29 something, means around 3000. So what is the trend? Trend is that for around 1400, around 1700, around 2200, and around 3000. So if they frame a statement, then they will not ask the exact data. They will frame a statement like this, that from last one decade, tiger population increasing continuously. So that statement will be correct, because if we compare from 2006 to 2018, every year tiger population is increasing. So they will frame a statement like this, that from a one decade and one and a half decade, the tiger population is continuously increasing. Okay, so you pay attention in this particular part. And what other observation? Other observation is that the Pench Tiger Reserve, what is the location of Pench Tiger Reserve, is in MP. It recorded the highest number of tigers according to this estimation, this fourth cycle of All India Tiger Estimation. Pench Tiger Reserve has the highest number of tigers. And this Satyamangalam Tiger Reserve, what is the location? Location is Tamil Nadu. It registered the maximum improvement. Means whatever earlier there were number of tigers in the Satyamangalam Tiger Reserve, the maximum jump, maximum increase of the tigers happen in Satyamangalam Tiger Reserve. So for our examination point of view, these two tiger reserve becomes important. At the end of this environment, I will provide you all those list of the national park and tiger reserve that you need to prepare. Those are in the news also, directly or indirectly. Okay. So what other observation? Other observation is that in the Chhattisgarh and Mizoram, there was a decline in the tiger numbers. Okay. And in the Odisha, tiger number remains the constant. Okay. And in the case of Northeast India, Assam have the largest population of tiger. And one very important observation is that three tiger reserve is there: Buxa Tiger Reserve, Dempa Tiger Reserve, and Plumau Tiger Reserve. These three tiger reserve, they are tiger reserve, okay? But there is no traces of the animal was found. Means they are tiger reserve, but there is no tiger inside this three tiger reserve. So if the examination, a statement is formed that Buxa, Dempa, and Plumau Tiger Reserve have no tiger, then you may be confused that it is tiger reserve, then there will be definitely tiger, but there is no traces of tiger. So that statement will become correct. Okay. So you take care of this particular fact. It is very important. And after that, this Madhya Pradesh Pench Sanctuary and Kerala's Periyar Sanctuary, those observation, those wildlife sanctuary or tiger reserve, which are in the observation list, they becomes important. So what is the observation? Observation is that the Pench Sanctuary or tiger reserve of the MP and the Kerala's Periyar Tiger Reserve, they are the best managed tiger reserves in the country. Okay. And the Dempa and the Rajaji Tiger Reserve, Dempa is in Mizoram, this Rajaji is in Uttarakhand, they have at the bottom of the list. So from our examination point of view, we need to prepare this also, because they are part of the observation. So all those tiger reserve which are part of the observation becomes important from the prelims 2021 examination point of view. So this observation you need to take care in your mind. Okay. So what other observation? In India, there are five parts of the tiger areas. One is this Shivalik Hills and Gangetic Plains, Central India and Eastern Ghats. I will show you in the image also, Western Ghat area, Northeast Hills and Brahmaputra region, and Sundarban region. So what is the observation as compared to 2006, 10, 14, 18? Means how the number of tigers are increasing, decreasing. This particular trend is given, but this is not that much important. Okay. So this All India Tiger Estimation. Now, who conducts this tiger estimation? This tiger estimation is a quadrennial means it is conducted in every 4 years. First in 2006, then 2010, 2014, and then 2018. So it is conducted in every 4 years. Okay. It is steered by the National Tiger Conservation Authority. The technical support is provided by the Wildlife Institute of India, and it is implemented by State Forest Department. So three bodies involved in this All India Tiger Estimation. One is National Tiger Conservation Authority, second is Wildlife Institute of India, and third is State Forest Department. You please take care of these three names. It becomes important. Okay. So what is NTCA? What is WII? This all national and international organization, national and international organization, that I will deal in the organization part. Okay. There I will tell you what is the NTCA, what is their composition, it comes under which act. Okay. What is WII? Is it a statutory body or autonomous body? It comes under which ministry? So there I will discuss this national and international organization part. There I will discuss this national body, NTCA and WII. Okay. So this All India Tiger Estimation, three body was involved. NTCA, WII means Wildlife Institute of India, and State Forest Department. Now, for the conservation of the tiger, what efforts were taken at the national and international level? So NTCA, National Tiger Conservation Authority, NTCA has launched an initiative, that is the M-STRIPS. This initiative is important. Name, what is the full form of M-STRIPS? It is the monitoring system for tigers. This is Tiger Monitoring System. I stands for Intensive Protection and Ecological Status. So what is M-STRIP? M-STRIP is a tiger monitoring system. Through the help of this particular system, M-STRIPS, we monitor the tiger population. How we will monitor that, I will show you in the further slides. Okay. So it is a mobile monitoring system for forest guard. This point will become clear in a few slides. Okay. So one initiative is M-STRIPS by the NTCA. Another initiative for the conservation of this tiger is the Pittsburgh Summit. Pittsburgh Tiger Summit, it happens in 2010. In this particular summit, 13 tiger range countries where the tiger population is prevalent. What all those countries? I will provide you a list in a few slides. So these 13 tiger range countries where the tiger population is prevalent is, they met in Pittsburgh in 2010, and they decided that now we will take efforts so that the tiger population should be doubled in a particular country. That particular thing already I have explained you, that if a country have 10 tiger population, let's say, then they have to take efforts to make it 20. If they have 50, then 100. Means they have to double the tiger population. For that, they have to take the efforts. And the initiative was T cross 2. T cross T stands for tiger, and 2 stands for double. Means we have to take initiative so that tiger population should be double. So one of the initiative was Pittsburgh Tiger Summit 2010, 13 tiger range countries, and T cross 2 initiative. Okay, this is important. After that, one initiative was Global Tiger Initiative Program. This particular program is of World Bank, very, very important, because in the examination, you may be confused that it is a tiger conservation, means something related to wildlife conservation, and the body is World Bank. Okay, so you may be confused that it will not be by the World Bank, but you need to take care of this particular fact that this particular initiative, Global Tiger Initiative Program, it belonged to World Bank. Okay. And in this also, what will be the aim will be to increase the tiger number and to take the efforts so that the tiger number can be increased. Okay, so this Global Tiger Initiative Council, under this Global Tiger Initiative program, there is a council, and this council has two arms. One is the Global Tiger Forum, and another one is a Global Snow Leopard Ecosystem Protection Program. This fact is also important. Why it is important, when I will explain this particular initiative, Global Tiger Initiative part, then it will be clear. Okay. So this initiative, Global Tiger Initiative, it belongs to World Bank. And this Project Tiger, it started in 1973. And under this, when it started, then there were 9 tiger reserves. But at present, there are 50 tiger reserves. And if we combine the area of all those 50 tiger reserves, then it becomes around 2.2% of the country's geographical area. So this fact also becomes very, very important. They may or may not ask direct fact, but they will frame the statement like this. They may frame the statement that the tiger reserve has around 20% of the country's population, to country's geographical area. That will be straightforward wrong, because the area is 2.2. They will make a smart statement. So you take care of this thing, okay? Now, what is the need for tiger conservation? So this question may come in your mind, means why we are going to conserve the tiger. For that, this tiger species, it is a flagship and umbrella species both. And this both thing I have explained you. What is the difference between in the species part, where we discussed many species. One was the keystone species. Another was the flagship species. Third was indicator species. And fourth was umbrella species. In one of my previous class, already I have explained you what is flagship and what is umbrella species. Do you remember? Or you forgot? If you will not revise, then you will forget everything. Okay, so revision, most of the time I have told you that revision should be part of your daily schedule. Without revision, you will forget everything. Okay, because the syllabus is very huge syllabus. So in that particular lecture, we have discussed this flagship and umbrella species. I am giving here just passing reference. What was umbrella species? Umbrella species, let's say we want to conserve a particular species, this particular species, but this particular species A, it depends on other species B, it depends on C also, it depends on D also. So we want to conserve this particular species A, but to conserve this species A, we also need to conserve species B, C, and D. So it becomes umbrella species. Umbrella means, here in this umbrella, there was tiger, but along with tiger, this conservation effort of the tiger, it will save the other species also. Okay. So what was the concept of umbrella species? By protecting the area required to maintain a viable population of the umbrella species, managers expect to be able to conserve viable population of other target species also. Means we were targeting to conserve one species, but that one species required a huge area. So that huge area, it will support for the protection of other species also. That was the concept of umbrella species. What was the concept of flagship species? Flagship species, it is basically a type of ambassador species. What was ambassador species? If you are able to remember this slide, I have explained you in the previous lecture. So flagship species is a species selected as an ambassador, icon or symbol for a defined habitat issue, campaign or environmental cause, then it will be called flagship species. One of the example was that red panda, okay? And umbrella species already I have explained you, and this slide we have explained, I have explained you in the previous lecture also. So the tiger is a flagship and umbrella species also. So conservation of tiger, it will lead to conservation of many other species also. So we need to conserve the tiger. And if we talk about the India, then around 70% of the population of the total world's tiger population is in India. So it becomes very important to take steps for the conservation of the tiger. Okay. So this initiative of the NTC M strips on this, in previous years, and I think in prelims 2017, a question came regarding this initiative M strips. So what is this M strips? M strips is monitoring system for tigers. It is a tiger monitoring system, intensive protection and ecological status. It is the full form of M strips. So it is a tiger monitoring system. You need to remember this particular part. This particular initiative, it was launched by NTCA and Wildlife Institute of India in 2010. And in this, a software based monitoring system, this particular M strip, software based monitoring system is this, and it designated to assist the wildlife protection. And how it works in this particular initiative, there is use of GPS. We use the GPS, and with the help of this M strips app and those images, let's say this particular tiger reserve is, and the forest officials, if for, let's say they are going in this particular direction, then if they will capture an image of this particular tiger, tiger A or B or C, then they will geotag. The geotag means with the location, the photo, whatever photo is captured, that photo will be recorded in the central system. Central GIS based system will be there. So let's say there is a forest official X that saw a particular tiger A. He will capture the photo, and that photo will be geotagged. So what it will indicate? It will indicate that a particular forest officials are moving in the those particular tiger reserve. They are doing their duty properly, because in the, with the help of geotagging, they can find out that the forest officials, they are doing their duty properly. The location aspect, it will be clear, because with the help of location, the higher officials can find out that this forest guard are doing their duty properly or not. One of the use, the benefit of this M strips is this. What is another benefit? Another benefit is that, let's say here there are many tigers. So there will be more number of photos will be captured from this area, and that will be sent to the central system. So now for the higher officials will get to know that this particular area have higher density. So they can take the proper protection area within this system also. They can make it a priority area, that this particular area, most of the time it has been seen that the tiger population is higher. So they can take the steps accordingly and conserve that tiger species. So 2-3 point you need to remember. What is M strip? It is a tiger monitoring system. It is devised by NTCA and WII. It is a software based monitoring system. It will use the GPS and geotagging. This 3-4 point more than sufficient. So what will be the advantage? Advantage already I have explained you, that it is a GPS based patrolling, helps in mapping patrol routes and maintaining a spatial database of patrol tracks, means in which direction the forest officials are patrolling, we can devise a routes. And let's say in this particular route A, there are often it is seen that many tigers are seen in this particular area, then the proactive actions can be taken for this conservation or protection of this particular area. Okay, so patrol maps helps the management analyze the trend and pattern to improve the future protection effort. This particular part already I have explained you. And this M strips will help identify the shortcomings in patrolling efforts in real time. because in this geotagging process, now the forest officials, forest guard, they have to go for and do their duty properly, because otherwise with the help of geotagging, higher officials will get to know that forest officials are, the forest guard is not doing their duty properly. So it acts as a proof of presence and patrolling of forest guards in a particular area. So these are the some of the benefits of this M-STRIPS initiative. Okay. Other, if any statement is formed in the examination, if you have understood the concept, then you can eliminate the option easily. So what all is different type of species is found in India? If we talk about a different type of tiger species, so there are Siberian tigers also, Bengal tigers also, Indo-Chinese tigers also, Malayan tigers, and South China tiger also. So in India, mostly it is Bengal tigers. So we need to study this Indian tiger or Royal Bengal tiger. This scientific name is Panthera tigris, not important from examination point of view. But this particular species, Royal Bengal tiger, it is native to India. And out of this different type of tigers, it is the most numerous of all tiger species. This particular statement becomes important, that there are many type of tiger species, but out of that, Bengal tigers have the most population. Okay, this particular point is important. And this largest, one more thing, this Royal Bengal tiger, it is found out mainly in India, but not only in India. Apart from India, it is found in Bengal also, Bengal is part of India, Bangladesh also, Nepal also, Bhutan also, some part of China also, and Burma also. So you should not confused with the statement that Royal Bengal tiger, that is the Indian tiger, it is found only in India, then that statement will be wrong, because it is found in other countries also. So in India, around 70% of the global tiger population is in India. And if we talk about the conservation status, then this it is endangered according to IUCN Red List. According to Wildlife Protection Act 1972, it is listed in Schedule 1. Schedule 1 means highest protection is given in this particular Prelims 2020. Prelims 2020. Question came regarding Schedule 6. Means the question was, if a particular species is listed under Schedule 6, then what will be the effect? So we will study this Wildlife Protection Act 1972 in great detail, because this Wildlife Protection Act 1972 and Environment Protection Act 1986, these two acts are very important from examination point of view. We will study this IUCN, what is IUCN, this body is International Union for Conservation of Nature also. So according to IUCN, it provides a status according to threat perception. And so it is listed under the endangered category. Wildlife Protection Act, Schedule 1. And CITES, it is Appendix 1. Okay, what is CITES? That also we will study. So if we talk about the tiger population, those 13 tiger range countries, which I was referring in the starting of this lecture. So those 13 tiger range countries are this India, Nepal, Bhutan, Bangladesh, Myanmar, Vietnam, China, Thailand, Laos, Cambodia, Malaysia, Indonesia. Okay, these are the countries which are part of those 13 tiger range countries. And what was the initiative? Initiative was T cross 2. In the T cross 2 part, the effort was to increase the... Somebody asking today's essay paper. Actually, this is environment current affair class. I cannot discuss in the environment current affair class the today's essay paper. Okay. That essay paper and all the GS paper, GS 1234 discussion will happen on the Diademy IS. Okay. But this particular class is for environment purpose. Okay. So these are the all countries which are part of those 13 tiger range countries. And the initiative was T cross 2. Okay. Next part in this is the slide, the same thing here represented in the form of image, that the MP has this much of tiger population. After that it was Karnataka, and after that it was Uttarakhand. There are given list of other states also, but you should know the trend that from 2006, 10, 14, 18, the tiger population is continuously increasing. Okay. Very important. And MP, then it is Karnataka. After the Karnataka, it is Uttarakhand. Okay. Same thing here listed, and here some reason also given that what is the reason of decline of the population. Means, for example, natural deaths, it is 55%, poaching 22%, seizures, this and this, not that much important from examination point of view, but this M-STRIPS mobile app, it is important. Okay, the feature was geotagging. And if we talk about the India, in India we have categorized this tiger, where the tiger is find out in five regions. One is Shivalik Hills and Gangetic Plains, this particular area, you can refer to this area. Central Indian landscape and Eastern Ghat region, this particular part. Western Ghat, this region. Northeast Hills and Brahmaputra Plains, talking about this particular part. And Sundarban, about this particular part. So in India, we have categorized the five landscape for the tiger population. Okay. So here you can see the here tiger population is very less in those states. If we talk about the Karnataka, Kerala and Tamil Nadu, then there are many tiger reserve. Let's say this Dandeli Ansi tiger reserve is there. Bhadra tiger reserve is there. Nagarhol, very famous one. Bandipur tiger reserve. Muddumalai tiger reserve, Satyamangalam tiger reserve, Billigiri Ranganath Temple Swami tiger reserve, Annamalai tiger reserve, Parambikulam tiger reserve, Periyai tiger reserve, and Kalakkad Mundathurai tiger reserve. We will study all important tiger reserve in great detail in our static lecture, okay, where I will discuss all the important points regarding for, let's say, this particular tiger reserve or located on which river, mountain hills. So that static part we will cover from static lecture, okay? If we talk about this northeastern part, there are also many tiger reserve. Let's say this particular Buxa tiger reserve, Manas tiger reserve, Pakke tiger reserve. This Pakke, it came in examination also. In one of the prelims, I think prelims 2017-18, the question was this Pakke tiger reserve or Pakke wildlife sanctuary. It is located in which state? Which state? Please mention in chat box. It is in front of you. Yes, the simple question, but direct question. Second, Pakke Tiger Reserve, Arunachal Pradesh. Yes, it is in Arunachal Pradesh. It was, I think, in prelims 2018. Direct question came that this Pakke Wildlife Sanctuary is situated in which state? There four option was there. One of the option, Arunachal Pradesh, is correct answer. So, okay. Another one, this Kajiranga Orang Tiger Reserve, Dempa Tiger Reserve. Okay. Namdafa and Kamlang. Dihang Wildlife Sanctuary. All other locational aspect also we will study in the static lecture. It is current lecture, okay? So this Dempa Tiger Reserve. After that, this same thing, the what is the location, those different location where tiger is prevalent. Let's say in Tamil Nadu 264, Kerala, Karnataka, Maharashtra, MP, Uttarakhand, and after that UP, Assam, other region have very little tiger population. Okay. So from 2006 to 2018, continuously tiger population is increasing. So our next news regarding the tiger is the status of tigers in India report. Next, second news is status of tigers in India report. This particular report, it was released by Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change. Okay, Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change. This report was released by this ministry on the Global Tiger Day. And the Global Tiger Day is observed on 29th of July. Project Tiger, already I have told you, started in 1973 with 9 tiger reserves. Right now, 50 tiger reserves are there in India. And in India, have 70% of the world's tiger population. Some of the repetition of those facts already we have studied. Okay, what are the repetition? That this tiger population is 2967, around 3000, and it is 33% increase, okay, as compared to 2014. And this Uttarakhand, this particular fact becomes important. Uttarakhand's Jim Corbett Tiger Reserve, this has the highest tiger density. Whenever you are taking about density, means it is comparing the number and area. So in the case of density wise, it is the Jim Corbett Tiger Reserve, and they have 14 tiger per 100 square kilometer. This data is not important, but density wise, highest tiger population is in Jim Corbett Tiger Reserve in Uttarakhand. Very important. After that, it is Kaziranga, Nagarhole, Orang Tiger Reserve. Not that much important, but this fact that the tiger density wise highest in Jim Corbett National Park or Tiger Reserve in Uttarakhand. The number wise, it is MP. After that, it is in Karnataka and Uttarakhand. And this particular 2010 initiative was aiming of doubling the tiger population by 2022, and India has already achieved this target 4 years in advance. This facts become very important because the 2022 is already approaching. We are right now in 2021, so 2022 was target year. So they may frame a question that India achieved 90% of the target in 2021. So they have not achieved 90%, they have achieved full target in advance 4 years. So this advanced term, you may be confused because you will feel that India is achieving the target 4 years in advance. It may or it may not happen. And in the examination, that extra thinking that will lead to the wrong answer. Okay. So this particular question came in prelims 2017. Please solve this question and mention in the chat box. So what is correct answer? Yes, all students have given the correct answer. The term M strips is sometimes seen in the news in the context of. So this particular term M strips, captive breeding of wild fauna, no, indigenous satellite navigation system. You can imagine this particular initiative. If you are not aware about this initiative, then you will feel that all the statement is correct. But if you are aware that it is something related to tiger monitoring system, so that the tiger population can be increased. So indigenous satellite navigation system, security of national highways, or maintenance of tiger reserve. So it is this particular statement is correct. So you can imagine the simple term. Many times this type of question is asked. Some term is in news, and the question is framed that this particular term is in news, it is in the context of, or it is related to. Okay. So for example, in the my one lecture number one, I discussed one particular term that was anthropos. Do you remember? Simple question can be framed that due to recently there was a term in news, anthropos, it is related to. If you are able to remember my first lecture, then please mention in the chat box. Anthropos. We have discussed in first lecture, first or second, current affair lecture. If you will not revise, you will forget everything. Now, we just read this M strips, so you are able to arrive at the correct answer. That is the maintenance of tiger reserve. This particular, when we discuss this particular term anthropos, after that I gave one question and you given me correct answer. But now after 1 month when I was asking, you are not able to remember. Yes, another name is great pause. Somebody is saying correct, it is great pause. But I was, what is it about? Anyway, you revise, go and watch this particular lecture, and there you will get the answer. Okay. Yes. Somebody has pointed right. It is a coronavirus lockdown period, and what is the impact of the coronavirus lockdown period? This particular term was related to this, anthropos. Okay. So please revise previous lecture. Now our next topic is that is the snake bites in India. This study was conducted by the regarding the snake bites in India. This study was conducted by the CGHR. CGHR means Center for Global Health Research at the University of Toronto, Canada. They have conducted this particular study on the snake bites pattern in India. And this particular statement is important that World Health Organization, this body is not that much important, so they will not ask. So World Health Organization, they have recognized this snake bite as a top priority neglected tropical disease. So it is a neglected tropical disease. What is neglected tropical disease? I will discuss in next slide. Okay. So this particular statement is important that snake bites, it is categorized as a neglected tropical disease. If we talk about the data, then around 1.2 million people have caused deaths due to the snake bites in the 20 year period from 2000 to 2019, according to this study. Data not that much important. If we talk about annually, then it becomes around 60,000, roughly for 58,000, not important. So this 70% of this death, those occurred in limited, low altitude, rural areas of eight states. So what all those is eight states? Bihar, Jharkhand, MP, Odisha, UP, Andhra Pradesh, Rajasthan, and Gujarat. This data is also not that much important, but here you can see that this snake biting is prevalent in mostly in these states. Okay, it is not evenly distributed. It is highly skewed towards these 12 states. And out of this, half of the snake biting has been occur in the monsoon period. This particular fact also become important. Monsoon period is the half of the snake biting has been observed. And this most of the envenomation, simple term can be what is envenomation? It is a process through which the venomous animals, they bite and they inject this venom inside the human body. So that process is called envenomation. The most of the cases, it has been observed that it is by the Russell's vipers, after that krait, after that cobras. So these are the snakes types. So simple question can be framed: Russell's viper, krait. This is general term, so their question, I think, no question will be formed here. But those terms which are in news, simple question can be formed. And this snake bite deaths occurred mostly in rural areas, around 97%. So data is not important, but trend is important. That what is the observation? What is the trend? That mostly it is affecting the rural area. And in rural area also, it is mostly affecting the males, 59%. Okay. And in the case of state-wise, it is highest in the UP. Okay. This particular fact also become important. So if there is the snake biting, so we provide them anti-venoms, so they can reduce the effect of the venoms that was injected by the snake. So the medicines are provided, anti-venoms medicines are provided to reduce the effect of snake biting. And in the case of India, this anti-venoms, they are mostly used for this type of four type of species: the spectacled cobra, common krait, Russell's viper, and saw-scaled viper. For those, anti-venoms are available. But apart from these four, there are other 12 species of snakes also. They are also causing the death, but for them, anti-venoms are not that much available, not that much important. Only the name is important, that these all are different varieties of the snakes. Now the question came: what is the neglected tropical disease? The term itself says neglected. Why it is neglected? It is mainly prevalent in the tropical areas, tropical and subtropical conditions. So if we talk about the earth, this is 0, 23.5 degree north, 23.5 degree south. So tropical area, subtropical area around 40 degree north, 40 degree south. So it is mainly prevalent in tropics and subtropic condition in 149 countries, and that affect more than 1 billion population. And they are called neglected. Why it is neglected? Because for those disease, those drugs companies are not focusing, because those drugs company are mainly works on profit basis. So this disease are mainly prevalent in those countries which have more population, the not adequate sanitation process is there. So it mainly affect those population living in the poverty areas. Okay, so it is not mainly focused by drug companies. Okay, so because they have profit motives. So the name neglected tropical disease, here you can see it is affecting this much number of people in the worldwide. And what is the example? The example becomes important. This particular slide becomes important. So what are the example of neglected tropical disease? Let's say in the case of virus category, it is a rabies by the biting of this dog. Dengue and chikungunya also part of this virus, neglected tropical disease. This particular part also examples of tropical disease. Lymphatic filariasis, you remember this particular point. This is in Hindi, it is called hathi pav. Lymphatic filariasis, okay. So in bacteria, it is the leprosy. Remember this particular point. In the case of protozoa, you remember this leishmaniasis. So all these diseases are example of neglected tropical disease, mainly prevalent in the tropical and subtropical region. Okay. Other details about this, you need to cover from the science and tech part, that what is responsible for which disease. It is bacterial disease, virus disease. Okay. So next part, two new butterfly species is covered. Next news is this. In one of the previous years, one question came that in 11 meter height, banana was discovered from which state? Which state? In one of the prelims, I think in 2017 or 18, this question came that there was a news of observance of the 11 meter height of banana. It is discovered from which state? Do you remember? Anybody remember what was the answer of this question? If you remember, please let me know through chat box. This question came in, I think, prelims 2017 or 18. So on the same line, this butterfly species which have discovered, it becomes important. It was Andaman and Nicobar. Andaman and Nicobar. Yes, Krishna has pointed out correct answer, Andaman and Nicobar Island. Yes, the answer was Andaman and Nicobar. So similarly, a question can be framed because two new butterfly species have been discovered. Butterfly is one of the favorite topic of UPSC. On the butterfly, previously question has been formed that if all the butterfly species is disappeared, then what will be the possible effect? Okay, I will solve this question in the static lecture. So now the news is two new butterfly species discovered. So what is important in it? The important is the location. So these two butterfly species name is striped hairstreak and elusive prince. And this find out in Arunachal Pradesh, very important. Location where these two species was found out, it is Arunachal Pradesh, okay? So what is specific features? Features not that much important. So name is striped hairstreak, the scientific name, no need to remember this name, okay? It was discovered in the Changlang district of Arunachal Pradesh. State is more than sufficient, okay? And it first discovered in Henan province of China. So here they can frame the statement that this particular butterfly species first discovered in India, then it will be wrong, because first it discovered in China, and now it is discovered in India. So it is India is not the first. You remember like this, okay? And this is that particular butterfly species. Next one is elusive prince. Elusive prince. This is also that butterfly species which was discovered from Arunachal Pradesh, and it was found nearby the periphery area of the Namdafa National Park. So due to this butterfly species, now this Namdafa National Park become important from examination point of view. The same important which all national park and biosphere reserve, tiger reserve, I will provide you a list on the basis of analysis of current, means what is happening in the current and in which particular news, which national park or which this biosphere reserve, tiger reserve was in news due to some other news, because this was in news because of this butterfly species was found. So it becomes important. Okay, one particular news that is in the Assam gas leak. Assam gas leak. This Assam gas leak impacted one of the national park also. In my first lecture, I discussed this Assam gas leak in the current affair lecture. It impacted one of the national park, that was the Dibru-Saikhowa. Dibru-Saikhowa National Park. So news was Assam gas leak, but it impacted in the Dibru-Saikhowa. So it becomes important. So likewise, I am preparing a list that which all national park, biosphere reserve or tiger reserve, Ramsar sites are in news directly or indirectly, because it is not possible to remember all the national park, all the tiger reserve, all the biosphere reserve, all the wetland site. Practically it is not possible. So all those which are in news directly or indirectly, we mainly focus on those areas. Okay, so this particular elusive prince butterfly species discovered from the periphery area of the Namdafa National Park, and this species was not recorded in India before. First time it is recorded in India. And very important point, you may be confused in the examination. The point is that this elusive prince in India, we have find out only male species. Very, very important, because in the examination, one of the statement is that regarding this elusive prince, we find out only male species. Then you may be confused that only male species, and only statement may be wrong. So the statement will be correct, because here in this case, only male species have been found out. So this statement becomes very, very important. Okay, so one of the question was regarding Kharai camel. Kharai camel, I will discuss this in the biodiversity chapter. So one of the option was that this Kharai camel species, it can swim up to 3 kilometer. Okay, so if you will think, it is camel, and this camel is mainly found in desert area. And the option is, it can swim up to 3 kilometer. It is talking about swimming of the camel. Definitely you will mark it wrong, but it was the correct statement. Okay, so likewise, this statement also may confuse you in the examination, that this particular elusive prince in India, we have found out only male species. Okay, so I will discuss this Kharai camel and what is location and what other features in the biodiversity static lecture, which we are discussing right now, the biodiversity chapter, that is very important. And this particular species also, first it is recorded in the North Vietnam. Location is not important, but it is important that it is not firstly discovered in India. First it is discovered in Vietnam, and now it is recorded in India also. Okay, so if we talk about the butterfly, then butterfly is an insect, and this insect belong to the order of Lepidoptera. Not that much important. What is of phylum Arthropoda? What is this order? What is family? This order, one particular arrangement is there that I will discuss in the static lecture. Okay, so what is the significance? It indicates the rich biodiversity. So if there are more number of butterfly species in an area, then the pollination process will be more. Butterfly is responsible for the pollination process. So if the more butterfly, will indicate the rich biodiversity. Okay, and it is an indicator species. What it is indicating? Presence of the butterfly species, it is indicating the health of the biodiversity, health of the ecosystem. Okay, so it acts as an indicator species also. So it provides us information on the overall condition of the ecosystem, that if the butterfly is present, then ecosystem is working properly. Okay, it also reflects the quality and changes in environmental condition, as well as aspects of community composition. And it acts as a pollinator. Okay, so you need to remember this particular point regarding the butterfly. Okay, this particular part will again come in the static lecture, where I will solve that question which came in prelims regarding that if all the butterfly species is died, then what will be the possible effect? Okay, so now Namdafa National Park. Namdafa National Park becomes important due to this discovery of this butterfly species. So first of all, what is the location? Location of this particular national park, it is located in the area of India and Myanmar. First, I show you the location, then we will come here. Here you can see, this is the Namdafa Wildlife Sanctuary. It is Myanmar and it is a part of the India. Okay, so there are other national park, wildlife sanctuary. Let's say here you can see Pakhui Wildlife Sanctuary, which came in prelims 2018. It was part of Arunachal Pradesh. In this year's prelims 2020, one question came regarding the Ascot musk deer. Ascot musk deer wildlife sanctuary. It is located in which state? So direct question came. It is one of the option of that question. So in the static lecture, I will discuss that complete question. So this Ascot musk deer wildlife sanctuary, it was in Uttarakhand. Okay. So similarly, whenever you are seeing a particular image, you saw all the aspect. Let's say in this case, this Brahmaputra river is coming from in this direction and it is flowing in this way. Okay. So they may combine the river and the location, hills and the location. Okay. Any biodiversity, flora, fauna and the location. Okay. So in the case of Namdafa, it is located in the border areas of Arunachal Pradesh and Myanmar. And in this particular part, it has all four species of big cat, that is a tiger, leopard, snow leopard, and clouded leopard. This technical or scientific name are not important from examination point of view, but you need to remember this fact, very, very important, that Namdafa National Park is the only park in the world. If this statement will be formed, then you will be confused that it is in India and it is talking about that it is the only park in the world which have all the four big cat species. Which big cat species? Tiger, leopard, snow leopard and clouded leopard. This statement becomes very, very important. And this Namdafa National Park, it also have this hollow gibbon. Hollow gibbon, what is the characteristic of this particular species? We will cover in the static part. But it is the only ape species that found in India. Very, very important. Okay. So these are the important facts regarding the Namdafa National Park. It is a location. Now we are moving to next news. This particular news is very, very important from examination point of view for prelims 2021. Because when you will see this name in the examination, question will come like this. Globa Andersoni. This particular term was in news in the context of. So if you have not read this particular article, then you will not able to arrive at the correct answer. So this Globa Andersoni, it is a plant species. Here you can see this plant species. And this particular plant species first recorded in 1862-70. By the Scottish botanist Thomas Anderson. This news is very important for prelims 2021. Okay. Because this type of article, which have some specific or different type of information, becomes very important. So first it is recorded in 1862-70. After that, it recorded in 1875. By the British botanist Sir George King. Names are not important, but the fact is very important that this rare plant species rediscovered after 136 years. Okay, so if they will form the statement like this, that this particular, if the question is like this, that which of the statements are correct regarding the Globa Andersoni, then one of the statement may be that this particular plants rediscovered after one century. One century means 100 years. They will not ask the exact 136 year, but they will frame the question like this, that in the question also, they will ask the fact also, and the statement will be very conceptually. So one century means more than 100 years. So it will become correct answer. Okay, the correct statement. So this plant species, which first recorded in 1862. So they may frame a statement like this also, that it first recorded in India pre-independence period. So before independence, it is around 1862. So that statement will be correct. Okay. So it rediscovered after 136 years. And from where we discovered that location also becomes important. And we rediscovered this plant species named Globa andersoni from the Sikkim Himalayas part. Very important. Okay. So due to this species, now the Himalayas part of the Sikkim, that also becomes important. Everything is interrelated, and this geography and this science and tech and environment, they are much interlinked subjects. Okay. So it is found near the Teesta River Valley region. So this is the plant species which survives on this particular rock. You can see here some water source is there, and on the basis of some water source, it is surviving here. Okay. It is one of the special features of this particular plant. So some features are listed here. This particular plant is also called, another name is Dancing Ladies or Swan Flowers, or it is thought that it has been extinct, but now again after 136 years, it has been rediscovered. So, okay. And according to IUCN, it is critically endangered. There, from this point also, it becomes very important, because all those species which are critically endangered, according to IUCN, and in news also, it is in news also, current affair also, becomes very, very important. Okay. And they are white flowers, and they have non-attached anthers. Okay. So if we talk about the habitat, then they are narrowly endemic, and mainly it is found in the endemic means they are restricted to some particular location. They are mainly found in Teesta River Valley region of the Sikkim Himalayas and the Darjeeling Hill Range. So question is, statement is like that it is found out in all over India, then it will become wrong, because it is found in narrow areas, narrow patches of the Teesta River Valley region. Okay, it becomes important. And it usually grows in a dense colony as lithophytes. This is also very, very important fact. Lithophyte means those plants which grow on a bare rock or a stone. In the previous slide, I have shown you that particular Globa andersoni on the stone part. Okay. So these are lithophytes, means they grow on a bare rock or stone. And they are mostly prevalent near the small waterfalls. Okay, from the near waterfalls, they get the requirement of their water and nutrition and all or other thing. So what is important regarding this particular Globa andersoni? It is a plant species, rare plant species. According to IUCN, it is critically endangered, and it is rediscovered after 136 years from Sikkim Himalayas region, and it is mainly found out in the Teesta River Valley region. Okay, so it becomes important. In the prelims 2016, this particular question came regarding the red sanders. So on the same line, question can be framed regarding this particular species, this Globa andersoni. Red sanders we have not discussed, so I am not discussing this question, but I attach this question to show you that how a question can be framed. Okay, so next part regarding today's discussion is high levels of ammonia. So high levels of ammonia in Yamuna River. So it is detected in July also, and in December also, this month, December 2020 also, there was a high level of the ammonia. So from examination point of view, it becomes important what is this Yamuna River from the geography part, and this pollutant, that is the ammonia, it becomes from environment part. So Yamuna River and the location and tributary that you need to cover from geography section. But what is the source of ammonia? What is the impact of ammonia? That we will cover in this lecture. So it was observed the ammonia population as ammonia percentage at 3 ppm. And according to BIS, Bureau of Indian Standard, the ammonia population in the drinking water, it should be around 0.5 ppm. So it is very greater number concentration of ammonia was found out in the Yamuna River in the July also and in the December also. So it becomes important. What is the use of ammonia? It is used in the fertilizers process. It dyes synthetic form. It is used in pharmaceuticals, leather industry, pulp paper manufacturing, rubber, water treatment. All these uses are very important because synthetic fibers also. Every year, at least one question is coming on the pollutant part. This year's, because earlier question came on the carbon sources of the carbon dioxide, CO2 sources question came. After that, sources of the oxides of nitrogen question came, oxide of sulfur question came, methane sources question came. And this year, prelims 2020, question was on benzene pollution. What all are the sources of the benzene? And this year, this ammonia is in news. So all these sources become very important. What is the use of the ammonia? Okay. So what some features regarding the ammonia? Ammonia is a colorless gas, very important point. And it is used in many industries, let's say in the fertilizer industry, plastic industry, synthetic fibers, dyes industry. And what is the chemical formula? NH3. So it is contains nitrogen and hydrogen, and the aqueous form is called ammonium hydroxide. It has a very pungent smell, very sharp smell, and naturally it occurs in the breakdown of organic waste matter. It becomes very important fact. This ammonia gas, naturally it is released when there is a organic waste. Let's say it is a plant leaves, organic waste is this. And when this breakdown of this organic leaves breakdown happen, then ammonia gas also released. Very important statement is this. Okay. So breakdown of organic waste matter, it also one of the reason for the naturally occurring of the ammonia. Other man-made reasons are the industrial effluents, contamination by sewage, agricultural runoff. The all general point is this, and it is lighter than air. And if the population of the ammonia becomes 1 ppm, ppm means parts per million, millions 10^6, then it becomes toxic to fishes also. So what is the sources and what is the effect of the ammonia? It becomes important. So one of the effect, this particular effect of the ammonia becomes very important. Why? Because when this ammonia, it reduces the oxygen in the water, reduces oxygen in water. Because when it is transformed into the oxides form of nitrogen. So in the oxides form of nitrogen, there will be use of oxygen. So this oxygen, when it will use, then it will reduce the oxygen in the water. So this point becomes important, that if the ammonia is present in the water, then it will reduce the oxygen in the water. And when there will be reduction in the oxygen of the water, it will impact the aquatic organism also. Okay. And where there was one phenomena also, BOD, biological oxygen demand. In the static lecture, I have explained this phenomena, that BOD stands for biological oxygen demand. It is for the amount of oxygen required for the degradation of the organic matter. So if the BOD is more, then the pollution level in that water will be more, because more pollution means there will be more organic waste. And for their decomposition, more oxygen will be required. So if the BOD is more, then the pollution level in that particular water sample will be more. So in this case, it is reducing the oxygen level in the water, means it is reducing the oxygen, it is increasing the pollution level, so it is increasing the BOD level also. The static lecture, you remember this part, I have explained you what is the difference between BOD and COD also. Okay, so this is very important thing, that presence of ammonia, it will lead to the reduction of oxygen in the water and increase of the BOD, biological oxygen demand. So it will indicate the more pollution in the water. Okay, so if the ammonia concentration is above 1 ppm, then it is toxic to fishes also. And if human are taking this water which have ammonia presence of more than 1 ppm or 1 ppm, then it will damage to internal organs also. So this effect becomes important. And after that, this Yamuna River, but you need to cover this Yamuna River from static lecture. I have attached these slides. It is the tributary of Ganga River, and it is its origin is from Yamunotri Glacier near Bandarpuch Peaks, Mussoorie Range, lower Himalayas of the Uttarkashi district of Uttarakhand. Every small information is given here. Okay, so it meets the Ganga River at the Prayagraj. And what is the important tributaries? Chambal, Sindh, Betwa, Kin. These are the important tributaries of the Ganga River. Yamuna River. Here you can see in this particular image, this is the Yamuna River. And important tributaries, Chambal, Sindh, Betwa, and Kin. Chambal River have one tributary, that is the Panas River. Other aspect of geographical aspect, and you need to cover from geography part. Okay, so next part, next news is that is a green agriculture project. Okay, so green agriculture project, name itself says this particular project becomes important from prelims 2021, because on the basis of aim, question can be framed. That which of the following is the aim of the green agriculture project, or what is the objective of the green agriculture project? So name itself says green agriculture project, means there are a lot of emission, CO2 emission, greenhouse gases emission from the agriculture activity. So if the aim of this green agriculture project will be that to reduce that emission from the agriculture practices. This particular initiative was launched on 28 July 2020. It launched in Mizoram to reduce the emission from agriculture. It is the aim. The aim is important, and to ensure the sustainable agriculture practices. Okay, right now it is in the 5 states only. If the project, the statement is like this, that this project is of, it will be implemented in the whole country, then it will be wrong, because initially it is as a pilot project we are starting in the 5 states. In the one of the state is Mizoram. Apart from Mizoram is Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh, Odisha, and Uttarakhand. And one very important fact is this particular project is funded by the Global Environmental Facility, GEF. So it becomes very, very important. Okay, and who is implementing this project? The execution part is on the Department of Agriculture, Cooperation and Farmers Welfare. Okay, and other organization also involved, let's say FAO, Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change, they are also part of this green agriculture project. What is the objective? The objective is to integrate biodiversity, climate change, and sustainable land management objectives and practices into Indian agriculture, and reduce the emission from the agriculture activities and promote sustainable agriculture practices. Okay, so it will be implemented till 2026. It will be implemented in all the states. Right now, its aim is to cover 35 villages, which will cover 2 protected areas also, Dempa Tiger Reserve. Now here you can see the news was regarding the agriculture project, but it is impacting this two this two tiger reserve also. One is Dempar Tiger Reserve and Thorang Klang Wildlife Sanctuary. It is in Mizoram. So these two protected areas become important. This is the thing you this is the art you learn, that which news you should prepare and how you should prepare. What is the target? Target data is not that much important, but what is the overall objective, that is important. So what is the important to promote the sustainable land and water management and to promote the carbon dioxide sequestration. Okay, because this agriculture activity is also responsible for the release of the carbon dioxide, this CO2 release also. So what will be the aim? Aim will be to focus on the CO2 sequestration. How CO2 sequestration, that I will cover in the agriculture section, means which type of agriculture activity we should promote, what is zero tillage, what is organic farming, and all this coming in the static lecture. Okay. So if we talk about the data in India, it becomes important because in this year's prelims from the agriculture part, 8 question came. And this particular news is regarding the agriculture section, so it becomes very important. So data is that Indian agriculture and livestock accounts for around 18% of the gross national emissions. And India and this agriculture is activity is at the third place. First is this energy, after that industry, and after that agriculture activity in terms of emission. Okay. And this most of the greenhouse gas emission, it takes place from these states, the Punjab, Haryana, UP, Bihar, West Bengal. Data not that much important, but this particular data is very, very important. That agriculture activity is at third place in the terms of emission. First is energy sector, after that industry sector, after that agriculture sector. What all steps taken by India for the promotion of the sustainable agriculture? India started this one of the mission, National Action Plan on Climate Change. In that one of the initiative, in this particular plan, there were 8 initiative were there. Okay, one of the initiative was that National Mission for Sustainable Agriculture. Okay, another Indian government started the neem coating of the urea. So to reduce the nitrous oxide emission on the neem coating of urea, one of the previous year's question also came. Okay, so that why neem coating of urea was started. Then there were four option were there. So it becomes important. And I will cover this in the static part. Okay, so why this urea was neem coated. After that, starting the sustainable and climate resilient agriculture system. Climate resilient means there will be very less effect of the climate change on the agriculture. We have to promote those type of activities. And one of the that in the INDC target, India was gave the target to reduce the emission intensity of its GDP by 33% by 2030 as compared to 2005 level. What is there apart from this, there were two more targets were there that I will cover in the static part. So we are studying all the steps taken by the Indian government for the promotion of sustainable agriculture. Another one is to promote the use of this fertilizer efficiently. Indian government provide the soil health card. In the soil health card also previously question was formed. In the soil health card, on the basis of analysis of the different soils and the nutrients on those soils, the different type of fertilizers are promoted, that which type of fertilizers in which quantity you should use in this particular soil. Okay, so after that, India have installed this around 2 lakh solar water pumps in under the Green India Mission. One of the objective is to expand the tree cover and to increase the quality of another 5 million hectare of existing tree cover. So all these are initiative regarding the Indian government taken regarding the agriculture activity, so that the reduction of the agriculture activity can be reduced. Okay, so one after that, this body came, body name was Global Environmental Facility. So this GEF, this GEF body, it becomes important because in one of the prelims 2014 question came regarding this GEF. What is Global Environmental Facility? It is a type of fund activity. It was established on 1992 Rio Earth Summit. There was one Rio Earth Summit. There are many outcomes of this summit that I will cover in the static lecture. But this GEF is also outcome of this Rio Earth Summit. And the World Bank acts as a trustee of this GEF. Okay, very, very important. World Bank acts as a trustee of this fund. This Global Environment Facility is a type of, it provides a financial mechanism. It is a type of fund, okay? So GEF serves as a financial mechanism for five conventions. What all five conventions? They become important. Convention on Biological Diversity, United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change, Stockholm Convention on Persistent Organic Pollutants, United Nations Convention to Combat Desertification, and Minamata Convention on Mercury. So this five convention, this GEF provides the financial assistance for these five conventions. It becomes important, okay? And it is a funds. What is GEF? It is a type of fund. In the static part, we will cover other type of funds also. So GEF, it is a fund. It is not a research type of activity, not this type of body. It is a type of fund activity. It provides the fund for the developing countries and the countries or economies in transition. For which activity? So that at the international level, whatever convention and agreement have been agreed for the meeting of those objective of those international agreement convention, this GEF provide funding to the developing countries and economies in transition. Okay, it is very important. GEF, Global Environmental Facility. So this particular question came in prelims 2014. Please try this question and mark your answer in the chat box. At least try everyone. Okay, so question is, with reference to Global Environmental Facility, which of the following statements is correct? First of all, encircle this point, correct. It serves as financial mechanism for Convention on Biological Diversity and United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change. Yes, it is correct. It undertakes scientific research on environmental issues at global level. I have told you it is a fund. It is a financial mechanism. It do not do this type of scientific activity. So if you have the basic idea about this body, that it is a type of fund, a financial mechanism for the developing countries or countries in transition, then you will mark option A as a correct answer. Otherwise, you will mark option D, both A and B. Okay. So in this case, answer will be option A. Okay. So before going to next part, that is a global e-waste monitor report. I want to talk 1 or 2 minutes regarding your preparation. If you have any doubt, means how is your preparation going on? How much hours you are studying? Anything you want to ask, one minute, you can ask. Especially regarding environment subject. Are you revising all the slides just after the class? Everyone, those who are attending the class regularly. If you will revise, then you will feel the subject is okay. Otherwise, you will get bored. And especially current affair class, because current affair class have the base in the static lecture. If your static lecture is clear, then this current affair class you will enjoy. Otherwise, you will get bored, right? Because you will feel it is a bombarding of the facts, but they have the logical connection in the static part. Okay, somebody is asking the slides from the one title as advantages of M strips. Okay, so advantage of M strips. Yes. Advantage of M strip. Before this. Yes, Mega. Are you talking about this slide? Before M strips, this slide, or next one, or previous one? And those who have enrolled, they all will get these slides just after the class. Now, sir have given me the access, so I will upload the class. So daily after the class, around in between 15 to 20 minutes, these slides will be uploaded. Okay. From very first slide to this slide. Okay. This was our first slide. After that, this one. And this is last one. Regarding M strip. Do you have any doubt in this? No doubt? Okay. So we move to our next part, next topic, that was regarding the e-waste. Yes, it is specifically Yes, it is specifically for tigers. Monitoring system for tigers. Translocation of tigers, it is a means type of topic. There are some positive also, negative also. It depends from which side to which side we are translocating. But overall, it may be beneficial if we translocate them properly and the tiger are able to survive, and if their number are increasing, that it will be a positive effect. So it is a mains oriented topic. In the prelims, there will be, in 1 year, the question came regarding the translocation of the Asiatic tigers, Asiatic lion, from the this Gir forest to the one of the sanctuary in the MP. Okay. So now we move to our topic, that is the e-waste. Okay, so global e-waste monitor report. First of all, this particular report, whenever you are reading any report, from the report part, earlier there were one or two questions were coming, but in the prelims 2020, there were zero questions from report part. But it doesn't mean that in 2021 there will be no question in regarding the reports, because in the 2019, 18, 17, continuously question was coming. No, in the neglected tropical disease, mega, those important, which I have marked, those names you need to remember. Or if due to some current affair part in the science and tech part, because that disease part, it is part of the science and tech part. In the science and tech part, you will study a different type of disease, that is for bacterial disease, virus, viral disease, and other disease also. So some names which I have underlined that you need to remember. And if any neglected tropical disease is in news in the science and tech part, then you specifically you need to remember that part. Okay. Okay. So in the prelims 2021, there was no question regarding the report, but in 2019, 18, 17, continuously question was coming. But it doesn't mean that in 2021 there will be no question. It may be directly two question. Okay, so we don't know which on which pattern this paper will be formed. We only can make our preparation comprehensive. Okay, so any type of paper, it may be current oriented, or it is the static oriented, or it is a mix of both. Any type of question can be, we can handle. Okay, only we can make our preparation comprehensive, because after the, if you will make your static clear and the current is not that much, then you will do not get the confidence, because this current part is very vast. So if you have not covered those current part, then you will feel that I am missing something, because it is very diverse part, is current affair part. Okay, so we have to make our preparation very comprehensively. So any type of paper will be formed, we will be able to solve the question and qualify the prelims, and after that we will prepare for the mains also. Okay, so anyway, this global e-waste monitor report, first of all, who released this report? It is a collaborative product, because many organization is involved in this. One is this Global E-Waste Statistics Partnership of the United Nations University. Another one is ITU, this International Telecommunication Union. It is also involved. One is the International Solid Waste Association. It is involved. And UN Environment Program, it is also involved. So this point, collaborative product, you need to remember. If the statement will be that this Global E-Waste Monitoring Report, it is released by only UNEP, that will be wrong, because it is a collaborative effort of the many organization listed here. Okay, so what is the trend? So trend is that in the 2019, worldwide total generation of e-waste was 53.6 million tons of e-waste was generated. And if we combine the per capita, then it becomes 7.3 kg per capita, I mean per person. Total e-waste upon total population of the world. So per capita, it comes around 7.3 kg e-waste we are generating in a year. Okay. And it is a 20%, 21% increase. This trend is important. Fact is not that much important that e-waste generation is increasing. Okay. And if the same trend will goes on, then between 2020 to 2030, the increase will be around 38%. It is the projection of this particular report. And in this report, it is highlighted that Asia has generated the highest quantity of e-waste. After that, America, after that, Europe continent. Okay. And if we talk about the per capita e-waste generation, then it is the Europe that is at the first position. Regarding the e-waste and the static part, regarding the e-waste, already we have covered in the static lecture. So what was e-waste? This particular slide I have attached from the static lecture. The discarded and end of the life products, the e-waste contains many, many type of pollutants also. The arsenic, which is responsible for black foot disease, barium, cadmium, which is responsible for ethi disease, cobalt, lead, mercury, responsible for Minamata disease, okay, silver, beryllium, plastic, chromium, all this slide already I have explained you in the previous lecture. Okay. After that, we have discussed each and every important pollutant regarding the e-waste. What is the sources and what is the effect? This slide already I have discussed. And this question also we have discussed in the previous lecture. Okay. Just solve this question again, just in 30 seconds, because it is a repetition. Yes, it is a repetition. It is talking about the computer waste. Which of the following can be obtained in the e-waste that was generated from the computer? Here, it is a plutonium, which is radioactive. Computer we are using everyday life. So radioactive substance will not be part of the e-waste that will be released by the computers, which is used daily use. Okay. So if we remove the seventh option, it becomes B 1, 2, 3, 5, 6. Already we have discussed this question regarding the e-waste or this waste generation. There is the international convention is there. The name of the convention you need to remember, Basel Convention. Okay, so Basel Convention is regarding the control of transboundary from means from one country to another country movement of the hazardous waste. Okay, there will be many convention. In the static part, we will cover what is Basel Convention, Stockholm Convention, okay, Minamata Convention. So this Basel Convention, you need to remember, it is regarding the transboundary movement of the hazardous waste. Okay, it is adopted in 1989 and it came into force in 1992. What was the aim? Aim was to protect the human health and the environment against the adverse effect resulting from the generation transboundary movements and management of the hazardous waste and other waste. Means to save the humans or the environment from this hazardous waste, this convention was adopted in 1989. Okay, so after that e-waste, if we talk about data regarding the e-waste in India, then India is a third according to this report in the e-waste generation. First, it is China, after that USA, and third e-waste generation, India is at third position. This fact becomes important. And regarding the e-waste, this extended producer's responsibility, what was it? Already we have discussed in the this static lectures that let's say a particular producer A is producing a mobile phone, consumer B is taking this mobile phone, and after the use of this mobile, the producer have the responsibility to collect back this discarded or end mobile after the use by the consumer B. So producers have the extended responsibility. This, they are producing the waste, so they have the responsibility to collect back. This thing already we have discussed, that this EPR, extended producer's responsibility, it was part of the plastic waste also. Okay, this slides, previous slides we have discussed. Producers responsibility organization, those organization which manage the this waste, that is the organization which manage the waste, those are called producers responsibility organization. Already we have discussed this. We have discussed this plastic waste management rules also, amended rules also. After that, in the this e-waste was the proposal was PRO, producers responsibility organization. They are handling the waste. Okay. After that, there was a amendment in the rules 2018. So all this thing we have discussed in the static lecture. After that, we have discussed this question also. It is a repetition question. This question is repetition. Please solve this question and mention the answer in the chat box in just 30 seconds. Yes, so EPR was, it was part of e-waste also and plastic waste also, but here the recycled plastic manufacturing and usage rules 1919, it was not, this concept was not in 1919. Okay, so correct answer in this case is e-waste. Earlier this concept was introduced in the e-waste and now it is in the plastic waste also. Already we have discussed this question in the static lecture. Static lecture, in the current lecture, you will be comfortable only if you have studied the static lectures properly. Okay. Because current is the application of the static part. After that, this marine plastic pollution. In the marine plastic pollution also, that plastic pollution we have covered. So there was a report. The name of the report is Breaking the Plastic Wave, a comprehensive assessment of pathways towards stopping ocean plastic pollution. This particular report, it point out that the annual flow of plastic into the ocean, it will be tripled 3 times by 2040. Okay. So if we talk about the plastic pollution, then the situation is very grave because we are producing every year around 300 million tons of plastic waste. Out of that, 8 million tons of plastic waste, it becomes the part of the ocean. So you can imagine 8 million tons of plastic waste are dumped into the ocean every year. And this plastic waste, it constitutes 80% of all marine debris. Okay. So, and when this plastic waste, due to the reaction of the ultraviolet radiation from winds, currents, and other natural factors, this big plastic waste, it is fragmented into small pieces. And it becomes the microbeads also, microplastics. Microplastics are those plastics which have the size less than 5 mm. And further, if due to this wind current and other natural factors, if further the size is reduced, then it becomes nanoplastics also. Nanoplastics are those plastics which have size less than 100 nanometer. So earlier it is the ocean, the size of the plastic was big. Now the size have very reduced. It have converted into the microplastics and nanoplastics. So this small particles will go more deeper inside the ocean. Okay. So it becomes more difficult also. So this plastic fragments into smaller particles termed microplastics, nanoplastics, and which disperse plastic even farther and deeper into the ocean, which create many other difficulty also. So there are plastic, alternate of the plastic was this biodegradable plastic. So what was biodegradable plastic? Term itself says that it can be degraded with the help of biological activity, microorganism, it can be degraded. For example, here you can see the cellulose based plastic. Biodegradable plastic are those plastic which are mainly formed with the help of plant produce. Okay, so but they have also some concern that it is not impacting the environment if there are it the environment is meeting the certain conditions, but that conditions are not available in the ocean. Another thing is that this biodegradable plastic, they are more energy intensive and expensive to produce also. These are the concerns of the biodegradable plastic. Another concern is that this plastic also biodegradable, but sometimes the marine organism are stuck in this type of plastic also. So this entanglement issue or ingestion by marine animals, this issue also becomes, it also not resolved in this biodegradable plastic. So these are the some of the issues of the biodegradable plastic. A possibility question can be framed that what may be the possible effect of the biodegradable plastics, means the what is the challenges of biodegradable plastics. Okay, so in the case of India, some data is given, but data not that much important, only one convention is important. In the case of India, we are dumping around 6 lakh tons of plastic waste into the ocean. Not that much important. India, what the efforts India has taken, India have become part of MARPOL convention. It is important. So the simple question can be framed that MARPOL convention is related to which? So it is related to the MARPOL means marine pollution. It is related to the prevention of the marine pollution, and India is part of this convention. India also have the prevention of marine pollution is also dealt with the help of Merchant Shipping Rules 2009 under the Merchant Shipping Act. Means this act is also for this regarding the marine pollution. Okay, and periodic the survey is done of the, this is the same normal point. This only the important point is this MARPOL convention. It is regarding the marine pollution. Okay, and regarding the plastic, government has taken many efforts. Let's say this plastic waste management rules, 2016. After that, it amended in 2018 also. Already we have discussed in the static lecture. Other state initiative, let's say this Kerala's Suchitva mission. This, according to this mission, if a fisherman is going for fishing activity and they are getting any plastic product also, so they will collect the plastic product also according to this initiative. So name is important, Suchitva mission, that is regarding the collection of the plastic along with the fishes. Okay, this plastic waste management rules 2016 amended in 2018, already we have discussed in the static lecture. After that, this microplastic part we have covered in the static lecture. These slides I have attached from the static lecture. I think previous lecture, current affair lecture number, I think 2 or 3, we have discussed this part. Okay, this beauty products. After that, we have discussed this question also. Try this question just in 30 seconds because it is repetition. So what will be the correct answer? Very simple question. Why is there a great concern about the microbeads that are released into environment? They are considered harmful to marine ecosystem. Okay, simple question. So you can see here, the simple type of question also come, very difficult question also come, and medium type of question also come. You should always focus on simple and medium, because that difficulty level, if let's say if there are 20 question is there, then around 10 question will be simple type of, 5 to 6 question will be medium type of, and around 4 to 5 question will be very difficult type of question. All the question have same marks, 2 marks, all question is giving 2 marks. So always you should focus on the simple and medium. Okay, after that, if you have time, then you should go on this question. And I am talking about the preparation mode. Okay, in the solving, in the examination also, you need to follow this particular part. Once when you are solving a paper, you should divide in different rounds. In the first round, you should go those questions which are you have sure short question. Second round, medium difficulty question. And third round, the difficult, very difficult question. You should approach like this. Okay, so because the always there is a limitation of time. Main issue is time. Syllabus is very huge. This particular exam has very huge syllabus. So you invest your time efficiently, means you choose the source, which source you should refer. You multiple time, when you will revise a source multiple time, then you will get the actual feeling of the subject. And when you will get the actual feeling, that feeling will be very important for solving the question. Okay, so that's why it is advised to refer one source 10 times rather than following 10 sources one time. Next part, that is a sustainable ocean economy for 2050 report. Okay, this particular report, I think the time has happened 9:30, so we will discuss this report and remaining current affair regarding this July current affair. Next lecture it will be completed, July part, then we will move to August part, August current affair lecture. Okay, so we will meet in next class, next static class. In the static class, I am discussing the biodiversity part. So that's all for today. Okay, thank you all. First slide again. Okay. This is our first slide. So Megha, are you able to understand this current class, because it is based on this mainly static part, other aspirant also. Today's class you may face some difficulty because more factual information was there, and the conceptual part was very less in today's lecture. But I cannot do anything, because those facts which are important, that we need to mug up. Other aspirant also. Megha, are you attending the class regularly, those static lecture? Okay, this was your first class. Then you definitely you may face some difficulty, because in this class those slides which I have some slides where already some annotation is there. Those slides are from previous lecture. Previous lectures. So if you have understood in this condition that it is your first lecture. Okay. Other aspirant, Preeti, Harry, are you facing any difficulty or it is first lecture for you also? So Preeti and Harry, are you attending those static lectures regularly or you are part of only current affair? Okay, so you are part of current affair, but no issue. Okay, so if it is first lecture, then I will advise to watch other three lectures also. In the current affair part, it is fourth lecture. So Harry, it is first class for you. Okay, then if it is first class, then I feel you may have faced some difficulty because the pace of the class, that pace have built up over a period of some lectures. It is my, I think, 18th lecture. 14th lecture already have happened in the static part and 4th lecture in the current part. So when you will watch all those current old videos, then you will be comfortable. Because it is loaded with many facts also, and many facts at the conceptual part already I have discussed, and the same thing I cannot repeat all the times that you can understand, because there is a specific time is allotted to me to finish this subject. So that's why I attach those slides so that those students who have attended that class, they will able to remember that yes, we have discussed this part. Okay, so we will meet in the static lectures. No issue. Okay, thanks to all.